Hi, I'm Kumi Taguchi. Tonight on Insight, when anger leads to rage, why does it happen and how do we manage it?
I went from 0 to 100 and she was looking at me in absolute fear.
I screamed from the top of my lungs. I swore at him. I told them that that's it, Mummy's running away. Mummy can't do this anymore.
Could rage ever serve a purpose?
It's almost an adrenaline rush that you chase.
Despite the vicious road rage attack on you, you didn't retaliate.
You have to make snap decisions.
I'm a high candidate for a rage episode. I'm living on hope.
Hello, thank you for being here. Lauren, you recently had a rage attack during COVID lockdown. What happened?
It was a beautiful, sunny Sunday morning. My husband and I were dropping our 18-month-old daughter to her grandparents and driving back from their house via the beach, I just saw so many people out and about. No one was wearing masks, no one was social distancing, people were stopping on the footpath and chatting to their friends. There was just people everywhere. And I just, I snapped, I lost it. And I just couldn't stop yelling at these people. And it just kept brewing and brewing in the car. And I got home and I burst into tears and couldn't control it anymore.
Do you consider yourself an angry person?
No, and I never really have. You know, I'm a pretty bubbly and happy person by nature. I think what I am is empathetic. I care deeply about making the world a good place. Becoming a mother has made me want to leave it in an even better place than ever. And so it's not so much that I'm an angry person, it's that I care about a lot of things. And so when I see those injustices or, you know, unethical behaviour, people doing the wrong thing, that makes me angry.
What does anger feel like to you?
It's this visceral feeling through your veins, your heart racing, your blood pumping, your lid blowing over. You know, it's this explosion of emotion that you can't control.
Your mum to 18-month-old Zoe, have you ever felt that kind of anger brewing being her mum?
I think most mothers can relate to it when you've been up all night with your baby, trying to get them to sleep, doing everything you possibly can to be there for them physically and emotionally. Not just through the night, but through the day as well. And sometimes there's just nothing you can do to make them sleep. And of course, that's infuriating when you've done absolutely everything you can to give them what they need and it still doesn't work. You can't control it.
Has there ever been a moment where you've just thought, this is too much?
Yeah, a few, definitely. I am very lucky to have the support of my husband to help pull me out of that. He often sees it before I even realise where I'm headed or how I'm feeling. And I'm very lucky to have that because I know that a lot of parents don't always have another support person.
Can you describe kind of what happens in those moments?
I guess it's like almost an out-of-body experience. You have your blinkers on and you can't see anything else around you and you can't look at the situation from an outside perspective. And it's very lonely and scary. And, you know, I think once you come down from that, you realise what's happened. The guilt and shame starts to kick in around you're a mother, you shouldn't be angry at your child. They haven't done anything wrong. They can't control their behaviour. And because we don't talk about it, it's pretty hard to open up about to even close family and friends.
Caitlin, you've got three kids. Is this something mothers talk about?
No, absolutely not. I think
We've come a long way as a society in now that we can acknowledge maternal mental health is an issue, and we can acknowledge that mums often feel sad, but there's a long way to go before women can feel safe talking about anger.
Is angry a word you would use to describe yourself?
Not at all. Pre-kids, I was happy-go-lucky, spontaneous, silly. There was always a reason to laugh, and it's definitely not been until I've had kids that I've felt this way.
What are the things that make you angry?
It's everything and nothing all at once. It seems like the most insignificant things, like a toddler spilling a cup or a toddler not putting their shoes on. But when you can delve further into it, you can acknowledge that it's the fact that you're lonely and you are sad and you're overwhelmed and you're tired and you're unsupported and so overstimulated by the noise of kids and motherhood.
Caitlin, what happens in your body when anger turns into rage?
I feel my blood bubble. I feel myself getting hot. I can feel my face flush. My hands clench and I'll often have nail marks in the palm of my hands from trying to keep it in.
Was there a particular incident when you realised that this reaction was more than anger?
Yeah, I was on maternity leave after my second baby. He was about 8 months old, so we were a fair way into it. And it was a normal day like any other day, and he was sitting in the high chair and my two-year-old had tried to pour himself a cup of water and spilled it. And how many times do toddlers do that in a day? He spilt this cup and I just screamed. I screamed from the top of my lungs. I swore at him. I yelled at him. It startled him how much I yelled. I told them that that's it. Mummy's running away. Mummy can't do this anymore. And yeah, it was really confronting and I thought, this isn't normal.
Were you surprised by your reaction to such a seemingly small thing?
I tried to decipher why I was feeling that way and I figured it wasn't depression because I wasn't sad, I wasn't crying, I was just so, so angry. And when I looked to the research, there wasn't really anything there to relate to what I was feeling. And I thought, am I just not meant to be a mum? Am I just not cut out for this? Because I've never heard of anyone else reacting the way that I had.
Did anyone around you notice the change in you?
No. Maternity leave can be really lonely anyway. It's not the holiday that it's often painted to be. But having a shift working husband and living in the country and not having access and outreach definitely compounded it all.
Monty, you still have scars from punching a window when you were a teenager. What triggers anger in you now?
What makes me angry these days? Just little things. As an example, today we were set up to do a recording at another location and we were supposed to go somewhere else. And there was just a lot of different things that weren't falling into place. It made me angry, but, you know, quickly I used a lot of the tools that I've been using for a long time to manage that process. There's things at work that I'm managing on a day-to-day basis where there's someone that's actually not doing nice things to people. And I'm trying to get the managers to do something about it. And it seems to be a long, drawn-out process where I think it's just a simple thing that should be addressed straight away so we can just move on with things.
So a sense of kind of injustice triggers that anger?
100%. I'm a big stickler for injustice.
What does rage feel like to you?
Yeah, I remember an experiment at high school where we, you know, basically put a bit of water into a Milo tin and we turned the Bunsen burner on and just slowly waited and waited for that heat to burn and bubble up, sitting around waiting for something to happen. And you know, you think that nothing's going to happen, then bingo, it just pops out of nowhere. And I believe lots of people are walking around, you know, with different levels of steam in that tin and something just ticks them off and I'm sure that people just snap and crack and they don't even know why they did that. I'm sure it happens.
Danny, you're a psychologist. Are we getting angrier?
I don't think that we're necessarily getting angrier. I do believe that there are a lot of circumstances that contributes to anger, especially with COVID and the lockdown. There are a lot of environmental factors that would cause people to experience more anxiety, more frustration. that would contribute more to anger.
What's the difference between anger and rage?
So anger, I'd say, is a very common and normal emotion that everyone experiences. Rage, I feel like it's an intensified version of anger. So when you feel the situation is getting a lot worse and then you're not able to calm yourself down and you have a lot less control of your behaviour and actions, and that can impact negatively on people around you.
Kirsten, you're a social worker. Would you say that people are getting angrier?
I think so. I think the social situations, the housing situation, financial situation, employment, COVID, it seems like it's becoming harder and harder to make ends meet. And I think that those frustrations, fears, inability to access the resources that they need to be able to make choices freely in life does impact to a level where people, the ones that I see, are feeling angrier about the victimisation that they're feeling in their particular circumstances.
And your experience with rage isn't just professional. When you were 15, you had your first rage attack. Mm. What happened?
Years and years of living within a domestic and family violence situation, probably sitting silently or distancing yourself to a different part of the house for many years when you're smaller, but getting to an age where I had all of the feelings that have been explained, you can feel yourself getting hotter, palms sweating. I actually felt propelled off the couch and to stand in front of my mother and my brother and to kind of hold my arms back and be able to stand up to the perpetrator and be able to say enough. But I remember distinctly feeling like it was very hard to stand up, my voice was shaking, all of the physical reactions and senses were making it really difficult to be able to function in that present moment.
It sounds quite frightening that your body could react in that way.
I think it's the rage that gets you to that place, but in that particular situation there was fear as well.
Was your rage effective on that occasion?
I think it changed the dynamic in our household somewhat, and I think that it probably gave me some power back, and so it prevented me from perhaps going into, you know, the school and brawling with other girls or punching them in the face. It gave me a sense of empowerment.
Tom, you're a professor in psychology. We've heard about how people feel when they're enraged. How does it affect us physically?
What happens is your heart rate increases, you get the sweaty palms, you get increased blood pressure, your temperature goes up, and all of these things are preparing you for action. And that action is to protect yourself, protect your loved ones. It's important to note that these basic emotions that we share with other animals, like anger, they're adaptive. They helped our ancestors survive problems that they frequently encountered, which was other people attacking us or attacking our group, our tribe, whatever. So we didn't live as long back then. So, of course, you know, getting angry and attacking people who were attacking you was adaptive. It helped you and your kin survive. But today, it can lead to cardiovascular disease and even early mortality. So anger can literally kill you if you experience frequent, intense anger very often for a long period of time.
Could rage ever serve a purpose?
I think rage is fairly destructive because you lose control. So there's no real point to engaging in rage. Anger, on the other hand, could be helpful. If you think about especially collective action movements, things like Black Lives Matter, anger there was very powerful. But there was a point where people were saying, oh, no, this is just rage, you're destroying property. And there was a sort of a backlash against that when things sort of got out of control.
Chris, what makes you angry?
It's usually injustices towards other people getting mistreated in a sense where they're not defending themselves or someone's using that power on top of them to put someone in a box.
You're an Afghanistan veteran. How has war affected your personality?
It changes who you are as a person. I joined the army at 16 and 9 months, and I finished my basic training at 17. I deployed when I was 19 and again when I was 21 to Afghanistan. And I remember my mother said to me when I got home, you know, what happened to my two boys? You know, they both went to war and they came back differently. And I said, it's kind of like you leave a part of yourself there, because when you go to war, you see what mankind is capable of doing to one another. And I kind of became more pessimistic and more, I suppose, bitter towards the world. And I just started to see things very differently. It was like turning the flame up on the stove. It just made me boil quicker.
Right, so you sort of felt this sense of rage building up.
Yeah, absolutely. I mean, rage, for me, I know people have mentioned it tonight, that rage is that kind of, you know, an out of control. I saw it more of a spectrum where it was like, you know, rage is just that past anger. And I suppose that comes from the military style of thinking, was that we needed to use that energy and anger and aggression and rage to be a combative force. So, you know, when you come back home, you've got to try and find a way to expel that energy, and that can be through sports, physical fitness, whatever.
Scott, you're also a war veteran and Chris's brother. Can you relate to this?
Yeah, 100%. A hammer is the go-to tool for a carpenter to get his job done effectively. And for a soldier, anger and rage is what we need to be an effective fighting force. You know, we can have some of the most advanced weaponry in the world, but without the person behind the trigger that's motivated enough to use it, it's pointless.
And Scott, how did serving affect you emotionally?
It wasn't really until I joined the Defence Force that I really started to experience the deep-seated aggression that you get taught and you need. And then since discharging, it's something that's it's like a bad habit that you need to shake. It's only in the last sort of 3 odd years that I've really started to address a lot of the problems, because they were becoming a real impedance on my day-to-day life. A good example is we had a family holiday probably 2 years ago. And, you know, you've got a four-year-old and a six-year-old in the car. They've been in there all day and things aren't going right. And the tipping point was a fitting for a gas bottle. We forgot that. So I had to go and try and find a new one. And the boys are in the back of the car and they were arguing over which pencil they wanted or some such. And I remember I just launched into this tirade. I think that the difference between, you know, anger is that it subsides relatively quickly with very little or no physiological reaction. But in this instance, it escalates very, very quickly, and there's a physiological reaction to how you react as well. And I remember just sitting in the car afterwards, just looking at... I remember sitting in the car afterwards, looking at the look on Ollie and Charlie's face, and that was... that was the time that I realised that this is a problem.
What does it truly feel like to fly into that rage?
I mean, it's sort of... it's hard because, I mean, when you're in defence, it's almost an adrenaline rush that you chase. But I find that more often than not now, the after effects, you just end up on a peak of a wave and then it all comes crashing over and you end up in the whitewash afterwards. And, you know, the fallout is that you're just stuck in this trough of, you know, depression and regret, and you withdraw from your family members and society so that you can protect them from the next peak.
Thank you. Chris, you were wounded in a bomb blast in Afghanistan. What were your injuries?
I obtained a traumatic brain injury, a lot of spinal issues as well. So I've got some desiccated discs, some bulging discs in my back. I was diagnosed with PTSD and anxiety and depression. Psychologically, it really messed me up.
One Anzac Day after you got home, there was an incident with your family. What happened there?
We had a few drinks and at the RSL, and an instance occurred where an old soldier started comparing their service to our service. And I remember Scott coming back into the RSL after he was waiting for a taxi, and he lost his bananas over something, saying that this guy was outside having a go at him. And he was in tears sort of thing. I'd already had a bunch of little kind of niggling comments over the day that kind of triggered me, and I think alcohol takes away that ability to kind of calm down, and you just go from 0 to 100 real quick. And I went outside and pretty much started ripping shreds off people, and I know that Scott came over to me and told me to calm down, and then I was already at that point of rage where I ran off and I tried, you know, getting out of the situation by leaving, and obviously Scott kind of grabbed me and I turned around and I snotted him a bunch of times in the head, and I just punched him. You know, I ended up going into the police station and I sat down in the foyer and just started crying. So yeah, it was pretty nasty episode of rage.
How did you feel after this incident?
Immediately, it was like regret, the guilt and the shame in yourself, and there's quite a lot of, you know, you really kind of, like a dog with his tail between his legs, you really want to try and make amends and try and repair what you've done. You really look at the event and use it as a turning point, and it was a big fork in the road sort of thing to address more stuff or, you know, change yourself, I suppose.
He got out of his car and became pretty obvious that he wasn't really interested in talking.
How often does rage factor in cases you're dealing with?
Oh, I would say it gets into 80%.
The drumming is a mindful practice. You're in the moment, you're understanding what you're doing. And that takes you away from whatever could be bothering you on that particular day, whether it's anger about something or anxiety about something. But it's a very much a mindful practice. I've always had a problem with anger, certainly as a young person. I was brought up in a home that didn't really have a lot of love in it that I remember. A father who was quite strict and disciplinarian in his approach to life. My father's anger had a couple of impacts on me. So I was always anxious, I was always depressed, and from that I had a lot of anger that kind of manifested itself, particularly in my early teens, towards being very violent. Anger itself can be controlled if you understand it well enough. Rage is a point beyond anger where you can't control it anymore, you've gone out of control, and in my experience it has happened primarily when I have been physically attacked. When I was a young guy, because of my dad, my ideas of masculinity, my ideas of being a man, all stemmed from this traditional view of hypermasculinity, and that was certainly a big part of my life. Be a man, harden up, big boys don't cry, all those stereotypical statements that I think we still see a lot around in our society today. The gym's pretty much always been a part of my life since I joined the Navy when I was 15. The gym was part of not just my training, but also part of who I became. Powerlifting was about setting goals. It was about challenging myself to do things I never thought I could. And then the feel good that comes from that, having this idea when I was little that I was not going to be much of anything, I was not going to be able to achieve anything, proving to myself that I could if I applied myself and I had the right people around me, that's really what powerlifting has given me. I think men today are still challenged with the way that we're taught how to express or how not to express our emotion. We get this consistent message through that to be a man you need to be stoic. Stoic means unemotional. Unemotional means you're not allowed to be in touch with these gentler feelings that we all have because we're all human beings.
Michael, what effect did having a violent father have on you?
My father's approach, his violence was the model that I followed. So he was the person that I wanted to be, like most young fellas when I grew up.
Was there ever a kind of sharing of love in the household, for example?
No, I never remember the word love passing between my father and I at all.
Did it affect your relationship with your siblings?
Yes, very much so. I passed the anger down. On the times when I would get a beating from my dad, my siblings, particularly my younger sister and the elder of my two younger brothers, would feel that. It was almost as if I had no control over what was happening to me and I had to take control by taking control over somebody else. It was a power thing that I wouldn't have been able to put it into those words as a young person, but I think fundamentally that's what it was.
Michael, you joined the Navy to get away from home. What was the atmosphere like there?
It was very much a jumping from frying pan into fire, because I thought I'd left this hyper-masculine environment, this need to prove yourself as a man, with my dad. And instead, the Navy that I joined in 1977 was more of that.
Your next job was as a nightclub bouncer. How did you manage your emotions in that role?
I became a bouncer during my spare time. I was still in the Navy at the time, because it was another ideal of this hyper-masculine person, this person that other men feared that women would flock to. I was employed primarily because I had a pretty good way of speaking to people, but I also wasn't scared of backing away from a fight when it happened.
Tom, who's more likely to get angry and aggressive?
Yeah, there's a lot of risk factors. So a lot of them happen in childhood and have to do with impact on the developing brain. So witnessing violence in the home, being abused or neglected. Genetics is half the story. Genetics accounts for about 50% of the variance in violence.
Monty, how was anger dealt with in your family?
My background is Palestinian and Ukrainian, and I think that my parents' skills with regards to their past histories when they came to Australia, I think they tried to just forget things and just cover things up. Yeah, there was tough times. Anger, it was kind of like suppressed. It was like that that analogy I gave before about that tin with steam in it. There was always a level of steam in there. And I didn't learn any skills from my parents on how to diffuse that steam, unfortunately. I've learned that afterwards, yeah.
Kirsten, what have been the ongoing impacts on you of violence in your childhood?
Definitely physical effects. I'm quite hypervigilant all the time, so anything that might trigger me, I tend to make a very quick assessment of whether I need to run or stay and fight. Tension, physical tension, high blood pressure, depression, anxiety, lots of having to be really mindful and use some of those techniques and really just remind myself to breathe and to ground myself.
Danny, what role do mental health issues like PTSD, anxiety, depression play in how well someone can manage anger before it becomes rage?
People who have experienced a lot of trauma and PTSD, their experience of anger and rage is a lot more emphasised. I think people who experience PTSD and anxiety tend to have difficulty managing difficult emotions. So they have less strategies to be able to manage those emotions, so that can lead to more anger or rage, the responses.
Lauren, what role do you think anxiety plays in your anger?
Oh, my friend anxiety. We're very good friends, anxiety and I. With my anxiety, I experience a heightened sense of responsibility. Mm. I worry about a lot of things and I overthink a lot of things. And I think couple that with being a chronic empath and caring about a lot, it's a recipe for anger.
Do you ever worry that you might harm your baby in a fit of rage?
I don't worry. I think there is this automatic trigger that can fire in me that stops me getting over the edge. Mm. I don't know what it is, but there is something that seems to just click into gear right at the very end of that moment where it could turn quite not pleasant.
How does it make you feel as a mother to realise that you've kind of reached this point?
It's frightening, and the guilt and shame that then comes with that, of that potential risk of harming yourself or your child, whether that be intentionally or unintentionally, it's pretty frightening and embarrassing and scary.
Caitlin, can you relate to that?
Everything that Lauren's saying, it just feels like I'm reliving it again, and
It's so heartbreaking to know that someone else feels it, but it's also so reassuring to know that it's not just me. It's the constant fear that I'm planting seeds of trauma within them. I was gifted a beautiful childhood and a beautiful family, and my deepest fear is that I'm the start of generational trauma that they'll carry with them, and I can't undo that.
Sophie, you're a sociologist specialising in motherhood. Why don't we hear more about maternal rage?
Because it's taboo. Because anger is not associated with what it means to be a good mother. And so when we feel those emotions that come up for us, and inevitably in many ways, it feels like we don't belong. Maybe we shouldn't have been a mother. Maybe we're not cut out for this. And that's really isolating and stigmatising. And it says something about our sense of identity. There's a lot of shame associated with that.
And we have pretty unrealistic expectations of what it means to be a mother.
We do. So we've spoken a little bit today about masculinity and toxic masculinity and what it means to be a man. And I would really like us to start to think about and question the expectations that are associated with what it means to be a mother. And that when we become mothers, we enter into this world of lots of pressures and shoulds, and certainly experiencing anger is not part of that picture.
Why are some mothers able to manage the stresses better than others?
We were not meant to raise children in the isolated ways in which so many of us do. And so how we're able to cope with and respond to and process anger has a lot to do with how well-resourced we are.
Michael, there were a couple of seminal moments for you when you realised you needed to change. What were they?
The first one was probably in a nightclub setting where I had a patron who'd been misbehaving, and we tried to have him leave the establishment peacefully. He didn't do that. He ended up threatening my family, my wife in particular. He said he'd find her and he'd hurt her. And that was a point where I went from the anger point to the rage point very quickly. I had my hand around this guy's throat, and I was talking to him very quietly, but explaining to him that this is what hurting people felt like. And my partner eventually had to tap me on the shoulder and say, "Michael, you've got to let him go." And that kind of snapped me out of the rage piece back into the anger piece, and I could see what I was doing. The poor bloke was on the verge of collapsing. So at that point, I went straight to management and I said, I quit. I can't do this anymore. I know that I could hurt somebody. The second time was more close to home, and it was after I returned from Iraq, and my wife asked me to hang out some washing. She handed me a basket of washing, and I completely lost it. I went from 0 to 100, and I started punching into the walls of the laundry, and I turned around to say something to my wife, and she was looking at me in absolute fear because she wasn't sure what I was about to do, either to myself or to her. And I realised that I needed to address these emotions that I felt and do something with them that could make sure that I wouldn't hurt somebody.
Around 70% of us experience road rage. Andrew, 3 years ago, you were driving when your car and another vehicle collided. What happened?
I was driving along. Another driver was next to me, and we had a minor collision. There would have been some panel damage. Nobody was hurt. I figured, OK, we'll pull over and talk about it, exchange details. But he decided to stop in front of me at a set of traffic lights. He got out of his car, and it became pretty obvious that he wasn't really interested in talking.
We actually have some footage of the incident. Let's have a look. So this is the incident there.
I'm not sure how, but my car jumped into gear, or I knocked it into gear or something. He wasn't real happy with that, so he sort of came back for a second shot, got in his car and drove away.
How were you after the attack?
I did a fairly good job of defending myself. I protected my head and my jaw, and I had some cuts and bruises, but I wasn't severely injured.
Patrick, you're a criminal defence lawyer, and you often represent people who are charged with road rage incidences. Is there a typical road rage client?
Well, no, there's not. And interestingly enough, that footage that we just saw, as shocking as it was in the criminal court setting, we see it a lot. And when it comes to the actual perpetrators of these offences, the analogy has been the Milo tin exploding. We actually call it, or well, I refer to it as red misting. What it basically is extreme anger, which clouds your judgment for a very momentary time. Now, in these road rage incidents, it can go over just the smallest road rule discretion. And a lot of the time, when you look deep into it, it's not the fact that this person's out for a Sunday drive. There could be something going on in their lives. They could have just had a terrible loss in their family, which puts them in this mood to start with, and then it suddenly tips them over the edge, that small wrongdoing towards them.
Patrick, you've also been a police prosecutor. How often does rage factor in cases you're dealing with?
I would say it gets into 80%.
80%?
At least 80 to 90%. But unfortunately, which goes with that percentage, is also, if you look into it, there's a level of alcohol. The level of judgment is somewhat impaired, and therefore that leads to the offences that bring them before the courts.
Jimmy, you're also a defence lawyer. Does the law ever excuse crimes that are committed in a state of rage?
No, there's no excuse for it per se, but when a sentence is imposed, it needs to reflect the subjective features of the offender. And the subjective features of the offender include things like whether there's genuine remorse, contrition, insight into the offence, especially whether there's a mental illness or condition that was underlying at the time that contributed to the offending behaviour. And more often than not, that usually is the situation with these types of cases, because it's not normal to go from 0 to 100 in that kind of context. And that's quite an important feature, because once you find out that is a contributing factor towards the offending behaviour, then the court can actually consider whether the sentence should be reduced only because a person who is suffering a mental condition or illness isn't an appropriate vehicle to be used for purposes of general and specific deterrence.
Andrew, despite the vicious road rage attack on you, you didn't retaliate. Is there anything that helped you deal with the road rage attack?
I think you have to make snap decisions, and I was fortunate enough to make some very good ones. I do martial arts. I was thinking, well, I'm safe here. I definitely think my training helped me from getting seriously injured and making a bad situation worse.
Monty, you have a daily ritual to manage your anger. What does that involve?
What I'm going through right now is an 8-year battle. So this face may not be the happiest, smiliest face. I've been fighting a leading private health insurance company, and it's a federal court case at the moment, and I can't say too much about that. So I've developed this ritual to keep me going. 8 years is a long time to be angry and someone destroying basically your life and everything that I've worked for. So those rituals include meditation. I also too do things like push-ups in the morning to release any frustration. So I did 150 push-ups this morning. Also too, I'm a big fan of doing cold showers.
Are there any other strategies you've found that help?
Other strategies? I'm a big fan of doing exercise as therapy. And I utilised a therapist that I use who does EFT or tapping, emotional facilitation technique. And every bike ride that I went through, whatever was something in my mind that was burning and I was carrying it on my bike rides, I would take it to the session and deal with it and process it, nullify it. And then the next bike ride, I'd be able to do further and further and further until I did this amazing 14-hour bike ride.
Incredible. Can you show us what that tapping actually looks like?
So basically what I do is I bring to the session what's, you know, irritating me or what's concerning me. We usually start off by having a chat, and I tap on my we call it a karate chop point there. And so we just tap and we have a chat. And after a while, she picks on the words that I say because our subconscious is expressed through our articulation of words. And then we do kind of like little mantra type things, and we go through top of the head tapping, and then eyebrow tapping, side of the eye, base of the eye, under the nose, chin, collarbone, and under the arm. And sometimes we go at slightly slower than what I just did then.
Breaking things and smashing things and throwing things and, you know, yelling and screaming and all that is my way of releasing my anger and into a way that makes me sort of feel better and better about myself.
Wilson, what do you feel when you emotionally eat?
I feel like all the terror and chaos in the world subsides.
It's always that chocolate bar, that bag of chips and that energy drink.
For so many years, it felt like this big secret.
After I'd finished my last bite, my last mouthful, then I'd start to feel guilty.
I always knew I had that rage inside. I always felt the world was against me just because I was constantly coming across hardships and sort of battles that kept on coming, you know, one after the other. And, you know, when I looked towards other people, I felt like they were in such a perfect world. So this pushed me further and further into this rageful sort of feeling. Hi, I'm Danny Mohammed and I run Smash and Splash here in Melbourne. Smash and Splash is basically just a place here where you can come and smash things, you know, break things, feel good about breaking things in a safe way and in a fun way. Having grown up with sort of ADD, which is that attention deficit disorder, I always felt like I was sort of always raging because, you know, I was different or I was perceived to be different. But as I got older, I started to come across a lot more sort of life experiences that sort of just added to that sort of rage. Watching my mum go through cancer, you know, my parents divorcing, losing family members in sort of some traumatic experiences, that has sort of just escalated that sort of rage. And my sister came to us and she pretty much brought all my siblings together and she goes, guys, you know, I know you guys are all hurting. Let's go and break stuff and smash things to pieces. We let all our emotions out in that one day and it was one of the most overwhelming feelings that I could, you know, could imagine. I basically went from anger, rage and frustration to a more empowering, fulfilling, calming experience. I've had a lot of people come through and actually go, you know what, I actually didn't realise I was that rageful or I wasn't that angry. And I'm like, wow, I'm like, well, there you go. You know, it's in all of us and we all have rage and you can't run away from it. I think what works for me is that, you know, breaking things and smashing things and throwing things and, you know, yelling and screaming and all that is my way of releasing my anger and into a way that makes me sort of feel better and better about myself. I don't think you can use us to sort of cure rage in a sense. I think it's a way that we can actually help people turn rage into a fun emotion.
Tom, how effective are smash rooms like the one we've seen here as a way of managing anger?
I don't know any study that's examined that question. I think, first of all, it looks like good fun.
It does.
So if you went in to have some fun, it's novel, you know, it's interesting. I don't think it's going to help too many people with anger problems. It's a really old idea, this idea. It's a catharsis is what it's called. It goes back to Freud, and the idea is that you get steamed up, and if you release it, then you'll feel better.
Right.
You might feel better in the moment, and that does tend to be true for people who really believe in that catharsis hypothesis. But in the end, over time, people just develop more anger and become more aggressive if that becomes a common practice.
What anger management methods do you think are effective?
Yeah, so we've been doing a few ones that are really brief that people can use. So for instance, in terms of like a road rage situation, so if someone cuts you off, you get very upset. What you can do is just pull over and engage in distraction. Distraction is super simple. You just pull out your phone, you play a puzzle game for 10 minutes, yeah. You'll feel much better. Another one that we use is reappraisal, which is thinking from like a third person perspective about the situation. Mm. So that same car example, you might think, oh, well, maybe they're in a hurry or they weren't paying attention, et cetera. Mm. The thing not to do is ruminate. So stew on it, think about revenge. Why? Well, that maintains anger, but also cardiovascular activity for a very long time. So it's putting more wear and tear on your body over time.
Danny, what tools do you teach people so their anger doesn't become rage?
So we generally look at psychoeducation as a way to start off with understanding emotions and being aware of those kind of emotions really help. Another method would be, you know, cognitive restructuring, so understanding some thought patterns that leads to you feeling anger, looking at helpful thoughts versus unhelpful thoughts. Other methods we use are mindfulness skills, so being present in the moment, and also just the breathing techniques where in the moment when you're feeling angry, what can you do? So count to 10. So give yourself a bit of space, a bit of time to take a step back. Just allow that emotion to calm down before you act on it.
Michael, do techniques like breathing help you?
Certainly breathing helps me a lot, gets me through the day. There's a couple of techniques that I've used, though, through the years. The first was to understand the fear that was causing my anger. What was actually triggering my anger that I could deal with then? There was a technique that we learnt as part of our pre-deployment training for deployment to Iraq that was actually called the happy place, and it's engaging your five main senses in a time and place where you were really happy, and that was to be used as a way to escape deprivations of capture, those sorts of things. And it's something that I've continued to use over the years to put me in a relaxed state.
Caitlin, you used methods like breathing to control your mood when you had your first baby. Did those techniques help you with your second?
No. I'm a physio, so I'm acutely aware of the benefits of exercise. So I tried using exercise, breathing, mindfulness, meditation, all of those things. And I mean, first things first, you don't have the capacity to do that when you have two small kids and you're parenting without a support network. There's just no time. So they just weren't practical, and they weren't effective enough.
What did you find helped?
Ultimately, it took a long time. I finally managed to get in to see my wonderful GP, who had a big, deep chat with me and said, you know, I think underneath all of this, there might be some depression, which had never been flagged because we don't tend to screen for anger when we screen for depression disorders. So he acknowledged that I probably was suffering from some postnatal depression and suggested that I started medication. And within 3 days of starting the meds, which were antidepressants, it was like I woke and it was a different world. I woke up and I could actually feel the warmth of the sun on my skin, which I hadn't felt in that whole time that I'd been pregnant. I looked at my kids and realised that it had been months since I was actively in love with them and nurturing with them beyond fulfilling my role as carer.
You've recently had your third baby. How are you feeling this time around?
It's such a different experience. I put a lot of effort into establishing a village because a mum needs support, and a mum with a shift working husband who is away a lot of the time and three kids under five needs a whole lot of support. So establishing those networks, I realised that it's okay to ask for help and I should accept help and I can outsource, and none of that reflects my capacity as a mum or as a woman. And it's just made such a difference in my postpartum experience this time around.
I'm so glad to hear it. Thank you. Chris, what tools do you use to deal with anger?
A big one that I've been using, especially lately, is the tactical breathing or the box breathing, really kind of getting my breath down and trying to just chill out. I've been doing a lot of fitness exercises, and I do a lot of fundraising as well. So I do like challenges of fundraising where I just try and exhaust myself by doing long endurance activities for charity. So I expend my energy through helping others as well, including at my local RSL and other charities for mental health as well.
Do you ever feel like you still might cross that line between anger and rage?
So I definitely know that, you know, in the back of my mind, the Incredible Hulk, so to speak, is still in there. But, you know, it's about making sure you know where the line is and how not to cross it.
Scott, how about you? Could you still cross that line from anger to rage?
Personally, I've got a lot of coping strategies in place. I'm actively involved with the RSL as well and another organisation called Young Veterans. and we focus on mindfulness, and we do activities like we go down to the rifle range and we do target shooting, we fly UAVs. They're all activities that you can immerse yourself in, and in doing so, all the pent-up anger that you've got subsides, and what you end up with is taking angry emotions and replacing them with something that you're passionate about. And, you know, the welfare outcomes are just amazing from what we've seen so far. So that's probably one of the biggest coping mechanisms that I use up here myself.
Kirsten, you're setting up a new business. What's your focus now?
My focus remains working with children, and my new business is private social work and play therapy for children that have experienced trauma. I am extremely passionate about that, and when I'm working with other people, I find it's a really great way to not be thinking about yourself, about your own experiences, but being able to really show deep empathy with other people for things that they've experienced and what they've gone through.
Monty, you're hoping to settle your dispute with an insurance company. How do you think you will cope if you lose the case?
As I'm listening to the stories and the process of this, I'm thinking that potentially I'm a high candidate for a rage episode. It's not who I am at all. I'm living on hope. If I don't win the case, I don't know what I'll do, but I'll deal with myself somehow.
Lauren, what helps you control your anger when everything just gets too much?
So the first is finding your village and leaning on them and not being scared to lean on them. For me, I find it really helpful to write things down. Yeah. These thoughts are invisible, and once you see them on paper, it's a lot easier to assess them. And, you know, you can put them in categories and go, well, I can control that, I can't control that. And really accepting that you can't control everything.
And what do you do with the things you can't control?
A wise old GP once told me, he just said, put them in your fuck it bucket. And so that's what I do. I visualise putting them in my fuck it bucket. Pick them up, put them down.
Perfect. Lauren, thank you so much. Thank you all for joining us tonight. It's just been the most fascinating conversation, and such an important one as well. That's all we have time for. Thank you too for watching.